I'm James Manyika, Senior Vice President at Google and Alphabet. I have the opportunity to be in conversation with my good friend, Father Paolo Benanti, the professor at the Gregorian University of the Vatican, a philosopher and also an engineer, to explore themes that he's been thinking a lot about, AI and society. Paolo, it's good to see you.
Good to see you, and thank you for this.
You and I have been discussing AI for over a decade now. But I think we're now at a really interesting moment. The pace of progress is extraordinary. What we see now possible with these systems often looks very close to the kinds of faculties, cognitive faculties and other faculties that we've afforded ourselves as humans. So does this change in any way what it means to be human?
Every time that we speak with deep mind people and they talk about protein and folding on protein and medicine and how that could be a new way to be healthy and to be alive is a new way to describe again what we are. But this time there is also a direct way because, you know, one way in which we change the understanding of human beings was among dialogues. And now it's not just a dialogue among humans, it's also a dialogue among machine and machine that can achieve or know or reach all the human's knowledge. When an LLM posing question to an user, it's not simple producing a text, but it's giving back something that for the user is something that bring a meanings. And the meanings is something that every one of us use to answer to the question, who I am. It's a new way to define or to describe what does it mean to be human.
In many ways, and we've talked a lot over the years about the ways in which this technology can actually empower people to do, whether it's creative tasks or everyday tasks. But as we've discussed, it also then raises a question about how should we think about human flourishing? How do you think about this question of human flourishing in an AI era?
Well, let me start from the positive outlook. That could bring us to a new renaissance in the way in which the other moment in the technology and the developing bring to renaissance, because it could be a new way for art, for music, for a lot of expression. But this is not given for granted, because what is needed is also a desire of the human beings to go further, to go deep inside that series of question. And the renaissance happened at the convergence of two things, a technological change, like the one that happened in the last renaissance, but also a cultural moment in which people start to push it over. Well, for creativity, I think that easily distribution of AI tools, because you know, you need a connection basically, could simple democratize such kind of moment, like the photography democratized the visual arts.
You and I served on the UN high-level body on AI, and one of the things we talked a lot about was this idea of how do we think about norms? What do you think are the most important issues related to ethics when it comes to AI?
Every time that you release a technology in a social space, such kind of technology produce a displacement of power and a form of order. Simple, try to think to a railway. Where you put the railway and where you put the stop is a way to make someone that can access the system and some way that can't. So there is a social, ethical, and political dimension of every one of this technology when they hit society that has to be discussed. Ethics is this, is questioning technology with the different stakeholder to try to make them part of this discussion. So ethics is something that could help us to have a just, for how much is possible in complexity, proposal of the outcome of this surrogative agent that we call AI. That's my perspective, but you serve in the body too. So what's your perspective on that?
No, I think it's an important question. And I think, you know, through the work we did on the high-level body, one of the things that did come through, which seemed to resonate across all the members, is this idea that there must be some grounding norms. One of them was respect for fundamental human rights. The idea, for example, that this technology should be used to benefit humanity seems to be an important consideration. Are you using AI? And what do you use or what are you using it for?
Well, you know, I'm fascinated by AI. You know, I like I'm a kid in the candy store. One is the use of wonderful Google product that is not a book LM, that is amplify the way in which I study a text. I put my highlight inside and I dialogue with what I touched me during my reading. And the system allowed me to multiply the question in a wonderful way, and I keep it in another book. The second one is really Franciscan one. You know, we live in a community and we have this old monastery, and the old monastery need a lot of maintenance. Well, with vibe coding, I was able to make a couple of apps that allow us to make new windows in the monastery. So yes, I play a lot with AI. I love it.
That's fantastic. You know, you've held and played so many extraordinary and important roles. And you often talk to heads of states and leaders. But you also, for a long time, was very close in advising the Vatican and Pope Francis on thinking about AI. What do you think, not just as a scholar, which you are, but also from a religious standpoint, are there some important questions you think about with respect to AI?
Well, talking by the Catholic Church perspective, there are 150 years that in the Catholic Church, there is one section of the reflection between the gospel and society that we call social teaching. It arises with the Industrial Revolution, in which society simply was shaken and new fragile category arise, new inequality was produced, and new distribution of power and richness happened. Well, AI is another chain in that such kind of revolution, and this is why the Church is involved to that. Pope Francis, the first act that he made publicly was to come in Sicily on a boat and throw a crown of flowers in the sea for the dead migrant. The second action that he made was the climate and watching the climate. The third one was the AI. He has this kind of antenna to really be in some way forecasting where the most fragile people could be treated by such kind of societal changing. What is the why that you're looking for?
The why of it for AI is the idea and the possibility that this technology could actually help and advance humanity in at least three or four ways. Can technology empower people everywhere to transcend any kind of barriers in order to flourish, whether it's in their everyday tasks or in the most ambitious sort of creative tasks? I think that's one. So we're motivated by that. In fact, it's actually grounded in Google's mission, which is to organize the world's information and make it universally accessible and useful. The second thing we think a lot about is this idea that this technology has the potential to power the economy, enable economic growth, innovation, and productivity. And then the third why is many of us are motivated by the potential of AI to advance science. AlphaFold is a great example. There are many others in material science, in understanding climate science. I think the fourth one that's also important to mention is the potential for this to help us tackle many of society's pressing problems, food insecurity, the effects of climate change, crisis response, floods, wildfires, all of these things that are pressing challenges. And we're already starting to see many, many ways in which this technology kind of can help us tackle those things. But at the same time, with powerful technologies, it's very important to also be very thoughtful and take the responsible aspects of this pretty seriously.
Yeah, you know, part of my background is also engineer, and one of my professors always used to say, think twice, cut once. And I think that principle fit wonderful what you say.
Well, thank you. We could go on for a long time, but thank you. That was fantastic.
No, thank you to you. It's, always a pleasure.